I was in Calcutta when I first saw the film, The Sound of Music. As I watched Julie Andrews sing, "The hills are alive with the sound of music," on a misty mountain, I remember the beauty of the sun rising over the Kanchenjunga ranges. I felt like she and I had something in common. We can both hear music in the hills. The only difference is that mine is real. I keep expecting this enthusiasm to wane. I keep waiting for that one morning when I wake up not raring to go. It hasn't come yet. I've been to this monastery hundreds of times to offer morning prayers. Yet each time, I find something new to inspire me. I love the cold wind, the mist that flows from one peak to another. I love that I came back to Kalimpong.
I always felt I was different, a misfit in my environment. I looked around, gazed at the surge of life that surrounded me, and I knew that I was special. Somehow I knew that I was meant for something more. I have lived in Kalimpong all my life. Maybe that's the reason I want to leave it. But until a few years ago, I never thought that I could. Until a few years ago, I saw my bleak future in the weathered faces around me and felt trapped. I don't feel that way anymore.
One!
Go!
I had never asked myself why I was always hungry. I just was. With five brothers, there were a lot of us to take care of. It's difficult being a middle child. It always seemed that my turn came last. I love my family, especially my younger brother. Someday, I hope to take care of all of them, like my father never could.
I pray every day. My board exams are coming up, and I'm looking for all the help I can get. But I'm also here to give my thanks. My friend got married yesterday. Her parents had arranged the marriage and had given her no choice in the matter. No one is going to force me into marriage. For this freedom, I have come to give thanks.
My father is a truck driver. He believes that you have to play the cards that life deals you. With a wife and a family of five to support, I think my father stopped dreaming a long time ago. But my mother is different. Her face lights up when she looks at me. She knows that I am different. that I dare to dream. Perhaps in my face, she sees the fulfillment of her own aspirations. It happened a few years ago. There was a school close to my house that had started music classes. I was needed at home to help with the chores and run the tiny shop outside our hut. But it seemed like an invisible hand guided me into the school walls, and there I have been ever since.
My parents sent us to the Gandhi Ashram School so that we could eat the 3 free meals they gave us every day. The first change I noticed was that I wasn't always hungry anymore. It's a great thing to have a full stomach. It gives you an opportunity to think about something else.
I love seeing the look on my aunt's face when she sees me off to school in the morning. My uniform, my books, my confidence, they're symbols of my liberation. I can see that she admires me. My mother, who works as a maid servant in Delhi, is proud of me too. For her, I am like a son, the first person in my family who will finish school. Every day on my way, I pass the Gandhi Ashram School. Every time, for a moment, I silently utter the same words. Thank you for changing my life. Thank you for giving me a chance. Thank you for setting me free.
Every morning, when I walk into this hall, I know I made the right decision by coming back. The violins are like old friends that I get to spend the day with. It's almost 8 o'clock. The children will start arriving soon and the day's activities will begin.
I used to come to class even before the music lesson started. At that time, it was just something to do between meals. A time out from home. I never made any effort to study. I never understood the importance of doing so. Most of my friends are from the same village as me, and we all come to school together. It takes us one full hour to walk the distance. And during the monsoon season, when the bamboo bridges get washed away, it takes us two full hours. But once we are here, it feels good to play and laugh and forget about everything else.
I've always been a good student. I knew from the beginning that education would help me achieve something in life. But big events are made up of tiny, everyday moments. And for me, a 12-year-old girl in rural Kalimpong, going to school became a struggle against society and against my own lethargy. When I first picked up a violin, I was petrified. But Rudra sir made me practice again and again, and slowly I realized that I could make sense of the notes. After a few months, not only did I have a knack for playing a violin, but I was performing much better in my studies as well.
When we first started learning music, I failed to understand what use it would be to me. Personally, at the time, I would have preferred something more practical, like carpentry or car mechanics. After all, becoming a carpenter or a mechanic was a definite step up from my father, who works as a laborer for a few months in a year. Now, I've changed my mind. I know I can be much better than a mechanic.
Aren't they wonderful? These children endure a life of poverty and deprivation, and yet they play Western classical music as if they were born doing it. Look at the concentration on that face. I think my biggest achievement is that I'm able to get a 9-year-old child to concentrate on one thing for a full hour. When I look at my students' faces, I see my own, 30 years ago. My story began in Darjeeling. I was an orphan, hovering around construction sites, earning a few meager rupees a day. Then, a helpful coolie took me to a missionary school, where I started learning to play the violin. It was a new beginning. I soon graduated and got a college scholarship to learn music in Calcutta. I joined an orchestra, earning more money than I had ever imagined. This was the life I had always dreamed of.
A few years ago, I was studying at the Gandhi Ashram School. That's where I learned to play the violin and joined the senior orchestra. The principal of Dr. Graham's Homes, a public boarding school, came to listen to one of our performances. After hearing us play, he offered 11 of us scholarships. I'll never forget the moment when I told my mother that I would be attending Dr. Graham's Homes. She hugged me tight and said that I needed a new pair of shoes.
Thank you.
My classmates in this school don't come from poor families. They don't know what it's like to be me. I have to work harder than anyone else, especially now that my board exams are coming up. But if I've made it this far, I have no doubt I can go much further. I came first in class again this year. English is my favorite subject, and I love reading the classics. I must have read Little Women about 20 times. When I go down to Delhi for my vacations, I tutor my mother in English. She actually speaks it quite well now.
When I play, I feel like a different person. This new person is full of music, separated from the world outside. As I watch my fingers move on the strings, I marvel that this melodious sound filling the silence is me. I love playing Nepali folk songs and symphonies by Strauss. A lady tourist from England once told me how people dance to Strauss in what is called the waltz. I hope to learn that dance someday. I wonder if you can dance and play at the same time.
When I first started playing the violin, I saw that people noticed me. Here was something I could do, which no one else could. I could read music from a sheet of paper, where others only saw a confusion of lines and dots. I love showing off my skills on the violin in front of people and seeing the awe and amazement in their eyes. My favorite songs are those from Hindi movies. I have never seen a movie in a hall, but Rudra sir told me that I play the violin almost as well as Shah Rukh Khan in a film that he had seen.
When I pick up my violin, it's like coming home. For me, this is not just an instrument. This is my friend and companion. The only time I have ever heard Mozart's symphonies is when I have played them in the orchestra. Yet, the music has become so much a part of me now that it comes as naturally as breathing.
Why
why did I come back to Kalimpong to teach music? It's a question I've been asked many times. I came back because I wanted to be able to give my students the same opportunities that I had had. I wanted to prove that children who had never heard Mozart or Vivaldi or Strauss in their lives could create music as well as any connoisseur of classical music. My senior orchestra now numbers 75, with children from the ages of 6 to 16. In last year's batch, 15 of my students got scholarships for higher education in expensive schools. 15 more children were given a chance they would never have had otherwise. This year, 11 more will become eligible for scholarships. Anu has a good chance this time. She has a lot of talent and can even teach music later on, if she wants to. In the end, it all comes down to the performance.
One, two,
film star. That's what I want to be when I grow up. If I study really hard and practice my music, I'll probably get a scholarship to go to a higher school like Dr. Graham's Holmes. After that, I'll go to Mumbai and work in films. Can I do it? Of course I can. If there's one thing I've learned, it is that I have a choice.
I'll go down to Delhi and enroll in a women's college. There, I plan to study economics so that when I graduate, I can find a good job and work like a man. I want to do this for many reasons. A better life, more freedom, but most of all, for respect. I want people to look at me and say, see, that's what a maidservant's daughter can achieve.
I never want to stop playing the violin. I want to study the great symphonies of all the classical composers and learn about them and their lives. When I leave the Gandhi Ashram School, I'll study Western classical music. I'll be a professional violinist and play in an international orchestra.
I've never seen Tegi dance so well before. He's obviously getting better. Anu is still as serious as ever. And of course, Soni, who now looks and talks like a lady. They still don't understand the entire significance of what is happening in their lives. Or do they? I remember listening to a song by a group called ABBA. The lyrics of the song went, "Thank you for the music, the songs we are singing. Thanks for all the joy they are bringing." No one will ever know the extent of which the lyrics of that song have touched my life. Now I hope it will touch the lives of these children so that they too can sing the way I have.